Welcome. The following video or audio are the study of the Bible, chapter by chapter, verse by verse of the King James 1611 Bible. Our family welcomes you to our household Bible ministry time. You may watch and listen with us. Our goal has been from Genesis to the book of Revelation. Each chapter by chapter we try, and topical preaching and teaching aids you can find by searching different topics. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Come and appreciate the word of God for our spiritual growth, our development in the word of God by these lessons. Please feel welcome to upload and share our Bible study with family and friends. Like us, subscribe, write a comment, let us know you heard the message. The video or audio are not copyrighted and should be used and not abused. Thank you. First Timothy chapter 3. Now, First Timothy is written to a man. It's not written to a church. Young man Timothy. So when we start off in chapter 3, this is a true saying. If a man desire the office of a bishop, he desires a good work. Now, I'm going to, maybe wrong, but I'm going to take, he's writing to Timothy. Timothy wants to be a bishop. And Paul addresses this letter not only to Timothy, but anybody who would read this. And this is what Timothy's, so far we learned, he's going in the ministry. He's being left at Ephesus. He's going to teach against heresies. He's going to teach the gospel. He's going to be called to pray for the leaders of this nation. He's going to bring them the saving work of God in Jesus Christ. And so to Timothy, thinking, okay, maybe he's questionable. Maybe Paul knows somewhere in Timothy's life he wants to be a bishop. Now Paul's going to relate to that in the qualifications. And Ephesians 4:11-12, more on this. And bishop, not pastor. Bishop. A bishop then must be blameless. Can't be blamed. Now, he may be blamed falsely, as Jesus Christ was. And yet they could find no fault in Jesus. So when a man's going to step up and be a bishop of the church, they may say things about him, but the government better prove we can't find no fault. And whatever deeds he does, whether it is conduct, his character, his bills, his business, we've already seen, you're to have a clean, positive outlook, outcome, character, business standards of all three we've read so far. The husband of one wife. And again, we run to, you know, you get a woman who's in the church, the head of the church. Well, we used to say, you know, what you're going to be, a sodomite, a lesbian. But you can't say that now today because guess what? They are lesbians. We are in a day and age today. Okay, all right, you're going to be a woman in charge of this church. Well, you're going to have the husband. You're going to be the husband of one wife. Yeah, I'm married to a woman. Used to be able to say, you know, we used to use that comical to prove that it has to be a man. But in this society today that we have worldwide, someone's got to be the husband of two lesbians. Someone's got to be the wife of two perversion. But the husband of one wife, and normally speaking, would be, he's got to be a male. He's got to have one wife. So the question is, here we go. What do you do with a Roman Catholic bishop? They proclaim them not to be married. So that violates what we just read here. And Paul's going to tell Timothy later, I'm not sure if 1 Timothy or 2 Timothy, he's going to say, those that say you can't marry, that's a sin. So that's a double whammy. So when you call somebody a bishop and he's not married, the Bible says it's got to be the husband of one wife. So this is more than a pastor of a church. Because a pastor can be unmarried. Here's a guy, he's going to have people over him. They're going to be married. And you know why you need someone to be married? A guy comes to you and says, you know what, I'm just having problems with my wife. Well, how's he going to relate if he's never been married? Huh? It's like, I forget what great man word would be. He would address the Pope as, you know, Pope would make things about marriage and stuff like that. And he'd say, well, listen, if you don't play the game, you can't make the rules. Saying, you know what, you guys are not married. And it was in reference to, you know, birth control pills and stuff like that. What the thing you hear is, you're going to deal with people who are married. And if you don't know anything about it, how are you going to counsel? And this is one of the things here, a young man, he hasn't lived enough life to understand the congregation that it's going to have with problems. So, vigilant. Now, that's not a vigilante. It's a big difference. It's watchful. It's attentive. You got to watch out for the flock of the people. And you got to look, hey, who's this person coming in this door? Who is this person that this person is talking to on Facebook? Who is this guy I'm going to have lead my church service for one day or for a week? Who is this group of people that are coming in? Why are they coming in? Where is Satan? And the churches don't have vigilant people. They'll let anybody come in. And vigilant. Again, watchful, attentive. I think the definition speaks more about that. Sober. Now, let's look both ways. Let's talk about as you know what? You ought not be intoxicated. All right? I don't think I'm doing justice to that. And sober is, he's serious. His outlook of life is, hey, I'm not saying don't joke around and don't have fun, but you know what? If you're going to be put in this position of a church leadership, everything's not a joke. You're going to have to teach the people. You're going to have to teach a person. You're going to have to teach a couple, a family. You better be serious, and you better not be joking around and fun play. Life is serious. Somebody calls you on the phone. You know, my wife just found she's got cancer. I'm gonna lose a baby, or we're fighting. That's not the time to have a sense of humor. Of good behavior. So you better behave yourself. How's that? Given to hospitality. What is hospital? What is hospitality? Helping you out to all means and necessaries that you have. How about hospitality? So visit your people that are in a hospital. Hospital, hospitality. The word hospital comes from hospitality. That guy is sick. That guy is not feeling well. Do whatever you can to make him feel better. You got to stretch yourself to even more than what you don't want to do. I was in the hospital several times. One time, you know, they told me, you know, bedpan and stuff like, no. I will go. I don't have to do that. But realize some of that stuff a nurse has to do to help that patient. Sometimes it takes grossness, gross deeds. Apt to teach. Now, isn't that great? You better be able to teach someone. It's just not, you know, I'm an old-fashioned, so I'm going to go by what I grew. It's not that guy with the gold teeth and a Cadillac and a big fancy suit. You better be able to teach the Word of God from Genesis to Revelation, and we're going to see mysteries show up in a minute. You better be able to teach doctrine on the virgin birth, the gospel we see in chapter 2. You better be able to teach how a man is saved. You better teach how a man is supposed to conduct his family. You ought to be able to teach money. You ought to be able to teach Bible doctrines. I've been in a church, you know, 45 minutes singing, 15 minutes if you want to call it a message, and you don't learn nothing. I mean, I don't know. Not given to wine. How's that? Now, wine, and like he's going to tell Timothy later on, this is a little bit more than just the grape juice. Because there's nothing wrong with grape juice. Grape juice is great. But the excessive sitting, fermenting wine, don't do it. Proverbs 31 or 30 says, you know what? It perverts the judgment of rulers and people of authority. It messes with your brain. If you're under the influence of alcohol of any type, you're not going to make reasonable decisions, and your life is not going to be led properly, never mind other people's lives. What are you going to do if you are drinking and someone comes up to you and says, I need to quit? Well, you know what? Now you're under conviction because you're doing the same thing they're doing. No striker. So I joke about that one. It's sober. You're not to be of a union. But a striker, according to Titus, it's quarrelsome. Now you take chapter 3 of Timothy and Titus, I forget what chapter he had, it is. You lay these out. Write them down on a piece of paper, the qualifications of Timothy chapter 3. And then you write down the other side, the qualifications of Titus. And a lot of these definitions will match to Titus. Scripture with scripture. I'm going to tell you what my life. I've been taught when I write books, when I stuff like that, you preach and you write what you know. I sat under a preacher that would preach messages glorifying how he would punch people, how he would get in fight with people, including his own wife. Well, I didn't know about 1 Timothy chapter 3 back then. But that guy is truly, truly, according to Stryker, he's out. Quarrelsome, always wants to start a fight. Always wants to, I mean, that's almost next to the person in wine. A drunkard always wants to fight. But this guy is a striker, not because of alcohol, because he's very conflicted. Not greedy of filthy lucre. That's money. He's not in it for the money. There are people that get in the ministry for money. It's a proven fact, I'm sorry to say. They do. They not only think, but they do. They sit back in a desk and they don't do nothing and people give them money. It's there. They pay other people to run to the, I'm not saying pastors do that. Pastors run to the water company. Pastors run to the post office. They have to go run and fight the tax people because the bill is wrong. They have to go to the store and get all this. Pastors do that. Then they got to go to the hospital. Then they got to go and, okay. But there are men in the ministry, they pay people to do that so they can sit on their butt and not do nothing and get all kinds of money. This would fall in the mega churches, your television, and most of your radio preachers. They're in for it for the money. Those people are not going to visit you in the hospital room. Those people are not going to visit you by a graveside. But they want your money. And they have found many cases where that prayer paper, that prayer envelope, whatever you sent there with prayer, goes in the dumpster and the check goes into the depository. So, hey, that's life. But patient. Patient. I don't like that word. Those are the words you got here, hospitality and patient. Things are not going to be quick. Things are going to drag out. It's going to take forever. You're going to watch a family. They're going to be in trouble. You're going to help them. And tomorrow morning, they're not going to be healed. It's not going to be right. It may take the rest of their marriage. It may not ever get right. They may make, I'm not saying they're not going to do it, but they may make the moves and it just may not. It's not going to happen right away. A family that's been in destruction, all that, it's going to take time. It's going to take time to take a newborn babe in Christ and grow him. Not a brawler. Brawler, that is a wrangler. Noisy. That goes a strike. He's tough. And he's noisy about it. He speaks with his fist. He speaks with his actions. Not covetous. Now that's things. You ever read about the money? This is things. He's not into television advertising. He doesn't want people's stuff. He doesn't want the people. In other words, he don't want the people to worship him. There are pastors out there, they want the people to worship them. They want to be the top of all in all. They want things. And we saw that with the ministry of the PTL. They wanted land. They wanted money. They wanted the music park. They wanted the city. And the Bible says that's wrong. One that ruleth well his own house. If he can't take care of his own house, how is he going to tell you to take care of his? Plain and simple. People are going to watch you. And if you can't do, how are they going to do? Having his children. Go back to verse 2. The husband of one wife, he's got to have children. That rules out the Roman Catholic bishop. That rules out a lesbian or a sodomite males. Don't tell me, I don't even want to hear about adoption and all that, because that's just disgusting. To bring a child into that mess. I don't even want to think about that. That's a wicked sin. Not only is sodomy a wicked sin, but bringing a child of innocence into that. That is wickedness. I don't even want to think about that. His children. You got to have children to be a bishop. Because not only you got to have a wife that know the marital relations and the marital problem and living with someone that's an adult with you, but you got to have children to bring in that extra spice of troubles and problems. You know, when a guy comes to you and say, you know, my child's in trouble with the law, my child's trouble with all that. If you don't know, if you don't have children, you never had problems with your children, how are you going to help them? The guy needs help. You're not going to say to him, if he's got wife and or children problems, oh, here's the Bible and read it. Okay, we're supposed to read their Bible, but when a person is over their head and they don't know what to do, they need help. In subjection with all gravity, that means those children in your house, we're going to see verse 5, they listen to you, they obey you, or they get out. Now, there's a lot of pastor children out there who are not living right, who are doing wrong, and they are not living in the house of their father. And there are pastors out there where the children aren't living in their father's house, and they're living in open sin and rebellion. That's wrong. And then you're going to get up before a congregation, you're going to say, well, you know, y'all not let your children do this. Well, your children are doing it. And in the eyes of God, in the eyes of the people in that pulpit, you are a hypocrite. That's what the Bible says. For if a man know not how to rule his own house, run that back to the husband and children. How shall he take care of the church of God? There are husbands, there are wives, and there are children in the church house. If you don't know anything about it and you have not had that situation, how are you going to take care of the husbands and the wives and the children in your church? Not a novice. That means someone who's fresh. Who's just come out of school. He's a newborn babe. He's a toddler. Even a teenager in the Lord. That's not old enough. He has not experienced life. He has not had troubles. He has not had problems. He does not study or have not learned the Bible yet. You can go to college, Bible college, and you can have the Bible put to you on a desk and take tests and all that, but have you lived them? Are you able to go door knocking or street ministry or pastor? Are you able to deal with people who are going to fight God? Are you able to deal with them? Without vigilant, without the striker, without being, you know, the brawler, being patient when you're dealing with people. Are you able to deal with problems with the Bible, with people, from what we've learned already? Do you have the skills for the ministry? Anybody can go to Bible school. Just because you go to Bible school and you got a piece of paper that says you pass, you may not be fit for the ministry. Not all education diplomas and certificates are you meet for the profession. If a guy goes through medical school or nursing, and he passes and he gets the diploma, and he ends up in that emergency room throwing up, he's not fit for that diploma. That's me. I can go to school, I can get all I need for the piece of paper, but I can't fulfill that job itself because I get sick. Least being, now watch this, least being lifted up with pride, this is a boasting, look who I am, I've got the PhD, I'm in charge of this church, I'm the pastor, if you don't like it, I've heard that. That church split. He fall into condemnation. Look at that word. He's being condemned of the devil. He's at right hand in fellowship with the devil. How's that? And you know what that could make him pretty soon? Was it 1 Timothy 11 or 2 Timothy 11? He could become a minister of Satan. And then turn around and deceive people. By his pride. Pride is not God. It's never God. So already now he is in the tools of Satan to be used by Satan. Moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without. That's without the church, the lost people. The people who do not go to his church. They ought to have a good report of him. There ought to be nothing. If they're going to say anything bad, it better be slanderous. If anybody would go anywhere this man goes to their business, hey, listen, this man such and such, I'm looking at going to his church. Does he do business with you? Yes, he does. What kind of report does he have as your customer? If he works, you go to where he works. You go up to his boss, say, how you doing? I know this guy. I want to go to his church. What kind of employee is he? Better be good. Better be good. Lest he fall into reproach. Somebody will have to give him a little message. And a snare of the devil. Look how the devil showed up again. A snare is a trap. Satan's like, all right, I want to trip this fellow up. How do I trip him up? I make his life and his conduct violation of what we read in chapter 3, and people are not going to have anything good to say about him properly. They will find guilt in this guy's life. They try to find guilt in Jesus, and all they could find was, I find no fault in him. Jesus had a good report among everybody, including his enemy. So, all right, that ends the bishop. Likewise, in all that we read, likewise, addition, must the deacons, all right, here's the deacons, be grave, and that's not dead. They're not in the graveyard. They're alive. Not double-tongued. That means they're not speaking bad about the preacher. They're not speaking bad about the people in the church. They're not speaking bad about anybody. And then when you're with the pastor, oh yeah, it was a great match. Oh, I just praying about you all the time, Miss such and such. And then when you're at home, oh, that Miss such and such, she's pain in the butt. You don't have two words for people. It's one word, double tongue. And you know what? Double tongue is, you know what? You may have something to say about somebody that's not nice, and you will tell them. It could be good or bad sayings. But you're not both positive and negative about one person. Double tongue. Snake has a double tongue. That double tongue, not given to much wine. Uh-oh. Verse 3 says, not given to wine. The deacon says, not. I wish it said not given to wine, but it says not given to much wine. There's a difference there. It says he can have wine. Not much. Not greedy or filthy lucre again. That matches the pastor, the bishop, the head of the church, the man in charge. Holding the mystery of the faith in pure conscience. We're going to see that in a few verses. So he, like the bishop, has got to be able to teach. And it's going to be a particular ministry that the deacons need to know. So you can't just be a deacon because you know the pastor and the pastor's family and you've got money and you're somebody of somebody in the town or city. You've got to have some Bible knowledge and you've got to have a credit. You got to have a character. You got to have a backbone. You got to be right. And you better hold to some doctrine. And let those also be first, be proved. You got to test them. When you call a man to be a deacon, you test him. You find out if he can do the ability. And if he can't, you got to get rid of him. You got to find somebody else. Not everybody who goes into the office of deacon should stay in that office. If they're not able to do that office, then, you know, you gave it the best shot. We tried the best ability, but you're not fit. I'm sorry. And that's where you got to swallow your pride and your humility and say, okay, yep, we gave it a try. You're doing right. May we pray for somebody who can do it where I thought I could. Then let them use the office of a deacon. So there is an office of a bishop, verse 1, and there's the office of a deacon. In this office, a deacon be found blameless. There is no charge, verse 2, the bishop must be blameless. Your conduct, your character, your actions better be found with no fault. And people will try to accuse you. People will try to bring up false accusations. They will try to discredit you. You better not allow them to do it. By truth. By truth. You better have like Job. When Satan went up to Job, God, you know, and God sat there, yeah, he's right. He's doing right. And the only thing Satan could charge was, hey, you know what? You're protecting him. You're taking care of him. Even so must their wives, oh, they're going to have wives. Verse 2. Be grave. So their wives are going to match them. Not slanderers. Ooh. They can't lie about things and people. So, now watch this thing. The bishop and the deacon. The bishop is, he's got to be the husband of one wife. There's nothing said about her. But when it comes to that deacon and his wife, she is given causes too now. Not the bishop's wife. You know who deals with the people more than the bishop? Going to be the deacons. Acts chapter 9, I think it is. 9? They say, listen, as far as those people ahead of the ministry, we're not going to take care of the tables. We have got to be given to study and reading the Word of God. You guys handle the people. Who? The deacons. Stephen was one of them. I know a man who was in charge of a church account, and he would sit at the table and tell you that, hey, you know what? This person must have got a raise at work because his check went higher for tithe. That's improper. Oh, I know these people. They got a good job, but this is how much they give. That's wrong. And the wives are not to do that. The deacons to deal with the people in the church, and their wives are not supposed to lie about the people in the church. Because it's the deacon's job to act to take care of the people, and if the wife lies about the people, they're going to believe her because she's the deacon's wife. That's wrong. Sober, again, serious, faithful in all things. That wife is to be faithful in everything. So what if the wife does not match? He does not hold the office of the deacon. What do you do with a bishop's wife? I don't know. It doesn't say anything about her, does it? So who's dealing with the people, according to chapter 3? The deacons. Acts. I forget. I think it's not. I'll have to check that. But let the deacons, and notice it says deacons, it doesn't say deaconess. It's not women. It's not an office for the women. Let the deacons be the husband of one wife. See? Just like verse 2. Bishop then be blameless, the husband of one wife, ruling their children and their own house as well. So they've got to be a family man. They've got to be in charge of their household. They've got to be a man. They can't be henpecked. For they that have used the office of deacon, well purchased to themselves a good degree. Well purchased. And that's not buying the office. To themselves, a good degree, that's not a diploma. That is their characteristic. That is their deeds. That is what they are. The use of the office of deacon has been to their credit. They have purchased by their work as Christ has purchased the church, not by money, but by blood. It will take them of giving, of loving. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That is purchased. That is charity. These guys should have giving and charity. Great boldness. They better stand up and be a backbone in the church. They better protect that pastor and the people at all costs. That's another good word for purchase. At all costs, they better protect that pastor and the people. Again, this is not physical guns and swords and all that. This is by mouth, this is by their character, and this is just by standing up. Don't you say that about my church people. Don't you say that about my pastor. Don't you say that about my church. You're going to say something like that, you better back it up. You know what? You're going to say something like that, I don't have anything to do with you no more. Get out of my conversation, get out of my life. In faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Boldness in faith, which is Christ Jesus. These guys are going to be out there witnessing and telling people about the faith of Jesus Christ to get people saved. A deacon is to be a witness, a bold witness. That's another office. That's another qualification. Don't you get anybody as a deacon or church that doesn't witness. These things write I unto thee. What we just read, chapter 3. These were written to Timothy. Timothy, you want to be a bishop? Okay, here's the qualification. By the way, you're going to need deacons later. This is their qualification. So if Timothy would have become a bishop, that means he would have to get married or is married. These things write I unto thee, hoping to come unto thee shortly. I want to see you. I want to be with you. I want to be in your presence. Paul would not say that about a carnal Christian. When Paul said, listen, when Paul said to the Corinthians, I want to come and see you, man, he said, listen, I'm going to be a rod or love. Paul said, I'll come with you in the spirit of love as Christian, or I'll come in with you with a rod because you're not doing right. With Timothy, man, I want to be with you. I want to be in your presence. After, look what he said, after verse chapter 1, I besought thee, verse 3, thee to abide still in Ephesus. Timothy, stay here in Ephesus. They need you. They really need your work. But man, I want to be with you. As I go to Macedonia, I want to come back to you. I want to be in your presence. I want to hear how you're doing. I want to hear what you did. How did it go? How did they treat you? What are things doing? I want to have fellowship with you. But if I tarry long, maybe a little while, I have no idea, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave. That's the theme of chapter 3. You better behave thyself in the house of God. Now, let's run back over here again to chapter 3. Verse 7. Moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without. So not only in the church house you're supposed to behave, but behave in the church house, but you better have a good report outside the church house. Now, don't you think Timothy already, Paul using him like that, you think, you know, Timothy is such a rascal? No, he's just reminding Timothy. And then Timothy is going to go start churches. And he's going to say, hey, this book was written to me. You want to be a bishop of this new church? You want to be in charge of this church? Timothy is going to get old one day. You want to take over my office as a bishop? Or you want to be my deacon in this church? Let me show you the letter that Paul wrote me. Timothy is written to Timothy, but look, it's in the 66 books of the Bible. It's not just for Timothy. It's for the church. It's for all. Don't you think, he said, I want to be with you if I tarry long. Don't you think Paul would love to have the company of all the Christians at the rapture? And hasn't it been long? Don't you think Paul would be surprised when the rapture happened? You get to see how many Christians there were or are. I don't know what English word that would be. Wouldn't you like to see all your brethren that have been suffering and living for Jesus Christ? Wouldn't you like to meet some of these people, you read their names? And I don't know if we're going to know, but put your arm around me, brother, that was a hard name. But you know me. You knew who I am in the Bible. Give you that credit. That how thou oughtest behave thyself in the house of... You know, I know children in church that don't behave. You're to behave in the house of God. That's 1 Timothy 3:15. How's that? They say Timothy is a young man. Of his age, I don't know. But as a young man, he behaved himself. I know young men that don't behave themselves. Which is the church of the living God. Our God's living. He's not a statue. He's not a person that's in a coffin somewhere, or a casket, or a urn, or, you know, pilgrimages and all that. He is the living God. And not only that, the pillar and ground of the truth. Now, wait a minute. Let's hold on here. Why do you got to do this? Because the Bible says it. What did Jesus say? I'm the way, the truth. So Jesus says, I'm the truth, and Paul says, the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. Guess who Jesus is, and guess who God is? There they are, the truth. So not only are we talking about God, we're talking about Jesus Christ. When we're talking about Jesus Christ, we're talking about his church, his bride. And wouldn't this match the way, the truth, and the life? Whosoever comes, no man comes unto the Father but by me? Well, he's talking about those who get saved. Without controversy. Great is the mystery of godliness. All right, remember we read over here at the deacon. Chapter 3, verse... I opened too many pages. Deacons. Verse 9. Having the mystery of the faith in pure conscience. Okay, what's the mystery? What's this mystery? Mystery of godliness. What's the mystery of godliness? This is what they're to teach. God was manifest in the flesh. What is that? That's the virgin birth. That is Jesus Christ, 33 and a half years, 100% man, 100% God. That is his entire earthly ministry. That's when he was 12 years old and he had the doctors and the Pharisees and all of them really, truly amazing who this young man was. This is knowing the prophecies of Jesus Christ and all that were fulfilled. This is from the birth of Bethlehem to the resurrection of Jesus Christ according to the scriptures. The deacons ought to better know this. How's that? Justified in the Spirit. Jesus Christ was just by the Holy Spirit. There was no fault in him. There was no guilt in him. Absolutely sinless. That deacon better preach the virgin birth, the life and death and burial of Jesus Christ, and that Jesus was sinless, justified. Seen of angels. He sat there with God and all the angels. He is seated at the right hand of the Father right now before all the angels. The Bible says when he was in that garden and he prayed, the angels came and comforted him. He says when Satan was done tempting him on the mountain, said angels came and took care of him. Preach unto the Gentiles. That's us. That's still happening today. Jesus is still preached unto the Gentiles. That's the book of Acts. You know what that deacon is? He's all to teach church history. Book of Acts, that's church history. That guy don't know church history, he has no business as a deacon. Believed in the world. People in the world believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. They were living in the world. They were doing the world. They heard the gospel. And they came out of the world and received Christ. Received up to glory, into glory. Acts chapter 1 is seated at the right hand of the Father. Not only do you got to know that, but you better believe that also. That is the foundation and the substance of the gospel. The virgin birth of Jesus Christ, till he is seated at the right hand of the Father, that is what you're supposed to believe. That means that deacon ought to be, has to be, saved and be able to teach what the salvation is. There are deacons who are not saved. There are deacons who don't know nothing about the Bible and given the position because of money, wealth, fame, and whoever. So this sets forth a stronghold of the church. And many churches don't follow this, and many churches don't even believe this. And guarantee a church that has a woman in charge, or a woman as a deacon, they don't know nothing. Plain and simple.